It's time for Sweet Home CannaBama, a show that'll answer all your questions, provide accurate information, and dispel the myths of cannabis. And have your specific questions answered by emailing jennifer@cannabama.com or text or call 343-0106. And now, for all things cannabis in Alabama, here's your host, Jennifer Boozer.
Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm your host, Jennifer Boozer, owner and founder of CannaBama in downtown Mobile. We're located at 558 St. Francis Street, just a block up from Wenzel's. And our phone number is 251-255-5155. You can find us on social media. We have a Facebook page, Sweet Home CannaBama. And then we have an Instagram page also, at Sweet Home CannaBama. And that's new, so we would love to earn some followers tonight. So go check us out on social media. You should be able to see us as well as hear us tonight, and you can watch the live stream from the Sweet Home CannaBama page and the Instagram page as well. Let's get on into it tonight. Before I bring on our guest in the second half, I have a lot of things to catch us up on. Current events, we're going to call this the State of Canna and Bama, and well, it ain't good. One victory. I will say, let's start with victory. I know everybody's tired of hearing me say HB 65, but that's because it was a huge, huge thing for the vape industry and the hemp and CBD industry, and we basically got a victory by letting it die on the floor. It never came up. Once it passed through the Senate, Children's and Youth Health Committee, it did not reach the Senate floor for vote, and we were very, very happy about that. Senator Smitherman, I hope I get to meet him someday because he is definitely my favorite senator. He has a way with words, and one of the things that he said in the beginning of the day, he was sort of the MC for the day. I don't really know the proper terminology for it, but he was the MC for the day and kind of in charge of the flow and talked a lot. And at the beginning, he said that today's agenda was full of BBs. And he said, I know y'all think that means bad bills, but that means boogabears. We were like, boogabears? He said, there's boogabears, bad things all in these bills. And I'm here to tell y'all to beware of the boogabear. So I think we're going to make some T-shirts soon that say, beware the boogabear, Senator Smitherman. And of course, he will get the first one. But anyway, I love the way that he handles these situations. He calls people out. Last year, we laughed a lot listening to him because he's one of the only people that I have seen that really says, hey, that makes no sense. So why are we doing this? And I have a fond appreciation for him. What does that mean now for vapes in Alabama? Right now, we're still in that weird place where in 2019, you know, they actually did ban these disposable vapes, but they did not have any funding in that bill to enforce it. So we're having some technical difficulties. So anyway, this doesn't really change anything. I mean, people have been selling these disposable vapes since 2019, pretty much unbothered, even though technically they are against the law. So I guess you can still keep buying your illegal vapes. You can certainly still buy the CBD and THC vapes that we carry at CannaBama. So yay, vapers. No one's going to be knocking over toddlers to get a vape. Boro hemp, let's talk about boro hemp. Mostly because I'm disgusted. Boro hemp has had basically a complete failure to raise enough funds to get this brief written. We talked about it before. The health department decided to send boro hemp, who is a product processor in Gadsden, Alabama, a cease and desist. They have been fighting it with a lawsuit for over 18 months. They have spent over $300,000. The health department has no jurisdiction. There is no law in Alabama that says that edibles aren't legal. And there is a state law that includes the word food in the definition of hemp products. So I still can't understand why they're even having to sue. The attorney general won't negotiate. He's not interested in that. We all know he's not interested in anything that has anything to do with cannabis. And I know a lot of people still see this as boro hemp's problem. You know, it's not. I've been trying to explain till I'm blue in the face over and over. This doesn't even just affect Alabama. There are other states, I know for a fact, Georgia, and I want to say Connecticut, but I may have that wrong, some odd northeastern state. There are states that are already calling and contacting the Alabama Health Department to see how they're getting away with this. So, because if Boro Hemp cannot get this brief done and get to court on June 3rd with the brief, which, by the way, takes at least 2 weeks worth of work, and we are there. But if they don't get that brief turned in and have to forfeit, or they lose because they cannot defend themselves with the brief, then they have said in court, I've seen written transcripts where they absolutely plan on going after everyone else. They were asked, you know, why, if this is so dangerous, if it's such a risk to public health, why isn't anybody else in trouble? And they said, well, we're waiting to see the outcome of this. They don't have a legal leg to stand on. I don't know how. In business, all I've learned about business and law is that the law is not written for the honest, upstanding business person just trying to make a living and follow the rules. It is not. It is made for the bad guy, because the bad guy always wins. The bad guy always has more money. And in this case, it's the state of Alabama. In the state of Alabama, you cannot even, they could, if they won, they could not turn around and say, well, the state put us through all this for nothing, and it cost us $300,000. We want our money back. And that's not allowed. So they can literally just, if they can't find a law that will back up what they want to do, then they'll just bankrupt you in court. And I don't want to lose edibles. I don't think that I would survive that in my business. It is my number one seller. For the life of me, you know, I donated $800 that we broke our backs to earn at 420 and give them. It's measly and it's almost embarrassing, but it was all I had to give. And it cost me, too. I needed that $800. But I need my business to survive more than I needed that $800. And I needed to do something to help this situation. Because when the health department comes for us later, I want to be able to say I did everything I could. And it's incredibly frustrating. I don't know why the mayor in Gadsden isn't getting involved. Because he was all over the news saying, oh, come to Gadsden. You can grow weed, you can process weed, you can sell weed, whatever. We want you in Gadsden. We're going to do everything we can to make it cost-effective for you to come to Gadsden. And here's Boro Hemp, been in Gadsden since 2020, putting money into jobs, into tax revenue, and doing community outreach. And he can't say a word? The weed people aren't coming anytime soon. They're too busy suing each other. I don't understand. I won't say what I heard. I can't corroborate it. I don't want to mess up what they have going on because I said something wrong. But what does this mean for the future of edibles? It means there won't be any. It won't. If they get Boro, even though they will be just as wrong with me and just as unconstitutional with me, they'll get away with it because our attorney general will let them, and they will have Boro Hemp as precedent. But every one of those states that's already lining up and licking their chops is coming for you. I know there are people that listen to this show that are retailers, processors, farmers in Alabama, but in other states, you know, I have tons of brands that I buy from and sell in Alabama, and our stores won't survive. And I don't understand. There are so many of us. Why we can't all put in $500, $100, $20, anything. But if you are buying and selling and making edibles in this state and any other state in hemp, you're going to suffer. You're going to suffer. I know that she went up to Champs to plead her case and was treated like trash, and I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed. So let's talk about Florida. SB 1698 will prevent stores from manufacturing and selling products containing Delta-8 THC, along with limiting products that are derived from hemp. So they've created this bill to ban hemp products for the most part, D8 hemp for sure, and some other hemp-derived products. From what we talked to Tom Wazlewski about with Natural, you know, my gummy manufacturer in Tampa, he said it was 9,800 stores were at risk, and that they have passed the bill, and all they have, all the hope they have is that Governor DeSantis would veto that. and it's real quiet over there, like it got real quiet here in Alabama. I don't know if anything has changed or if they've got any movement whatsoever on that, but it will be a travesty for the hemp industry in Florida. And, I mean, you know, that's where our gummy maker works. That's where he makes my gummies, and I'm not sure how that's going to impact us. Of course, we may not have gummies anyway. So people don't care. But under the proposed bill, the amended definition of hemp states that the level of THC cannot exceed 5 milligrams per serving and 50 milligrams per container on a wet weight basis. What is a wet weight basis? I don't know. When we come back, we'll finish up with current events. Stay with us.
Welcome back to Sweet Home Cannabama. Now with all the information you want about cannabis, here's your host, Jennifer Booser.
Welcome back, everybody. We're talking tonight on Sweet Home Cannabama, your home for all things cannabis in Alabama and beyond. We were just talking about our neighbors in Florida. Shout out to our Florida listeners and hey, Mississippi. And wherever else you're listening from, we would love to hear from you. This is our first video live stream. I'm super nervous because y'all, I'm usually in here with no makeup and sweatpants on. So, you know, I did my best today. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that my son got married today. So it's been a crazy day for me. We had tornadoes in the morning, marriage at noon, and then we had our first live show tonight. So congratulations to my baby boy. He is beyond happy, and they were just like, yeah, we don't really want to plan a big thing and then wait. And they've been together for over a year, and she is an absolute angel, and she matches him, and I'm really proud for him. So all of you who know Isaiah, make sure you tell him and Carmen congratulations to Isaiah and Carmen Boozer. So weird to say that. I couldn't have asked for a better daughter-in-law, though. Okay, so Florida, let's go back to this hemp bill. THC cannot exceed 5 milligrams per serving and 50 milligrams per container by wet weight basis. Initially, the bill sponsor pushed for even stricter limits, 2 milligrams per serving and 10 milligrams per package. We might as well not even, well, you'd have to eat like a bunch of them. Anyway, sorry, that's just me. but it was amended after receiving input from the hemp industry, probably tell them, have you lost your mind? Which is what I would say. So anyway, in CannaBama news, I got sick this weekend, and we were not able to go to the Mother's Day thing that I said we would be at. So if anybody showed up looking for us, I truly apologize. But we now have a website with an e-store again, finally. I know I've been telling y'all for probably months that we were working on it, and we do. CannaBama.com is live now. And we're still working on it. We got to still add the staff pictures and bios and some more information. And hopefully you can find episodes of the podcast. Once we're done here on the show, it goes up on every major streaming service as a podcast. And then now we will have the StreamYard available for you to also, if you get bored listening, you can watch. It's just me sitting here with headphones until I have a guest, though. Anyway, we have we're going to do it this way. So hopefully, when we have most of our guests that are out of town, out of state, most of them are out of state, you'll be able to see them. And I think body language and facial expression is important. So I'm really excited. I always prefer to have people in the studio, and now we don't have to do that. And so products, we've got some stuffed infused cookies from Sweet Tooth Confections, the one we're always bragging about, that comes to all of our events. We've got some spring flavors, some strawberry lemonade, and the Dad Bod, which is so popular. It's an M&M cookie stuffed with Nutella. And we've got brownies now and a churro cookie. So come check it out. I think there's strawberry crunch, too. That's my staff's favorite. Anyway, so tonight we're going to be talking to one of the members of the National Industrial Hemp Coalition, which I am a part of. I am the Alabama chair. But the topic tonight, we want to get more into federal scheduling, okay, the Controlled Substances Act. where THC or marijuana, whatever, I think it's just the one chemical that's illegal, being Schedule One. And President Biden promised a long time ago that he wanted to reschedule, look at expunging records, all this stuff, have a new attitude towards cannabis users and cannabis as a medicine. I'm sure you all saw it. You've seen clips of it on whatever your favorite social media is to consume. But we want to talk a little more about the difference between rescheduling and descheduling. All of this started, of course, you know, the Marijuana Tax Act in 1937 did not ban anything. It actually created a tax so high on hemp that it basically priced hemp out of what these farmers could afford to farm. And they had to basically abandon it. And then in World War II, they brought it back for the war effort, even had, you know, hemp for victory video, all that good stuff. Propaganda against their former propaganda, but then they went back to the old propaganda 10 times worse. But in 1952, there was the Boggs Act and then Narcotics Control Act of 1956. But in 1970, the Controlled Substances Act was signed by President Nixon. Probably the last, one of the last things he did before he resigned, before they fired him. So yay, Nixon. This was almost, well, it was 8 years before I was even born, and here I am dealing with it. So the Controlled Substances Act classified cannabis as a Schedule One federally controlled drug next to heroin, LSD, and ecstasy. It's the only class where the substance is listed to have zero medical use and high probability of addiction. Cocaine and fentanyl, which is killing people left and right in this country, are considered Schedule Two, which is mind-blowing to me. Maybe they put it on there before they started handing it out at pain clinics about 10, 15 years ago. And then there's the Anti-Drug Abuse Act of 1986, which the then-Senator Joe Biden co-crafted to authorize new funding for drug treatment programs and stricter penalties for drug offenses and, you know, all in the middle of the war on drugs. So reform via Schedule 2 or 3 listing could have ripple effects related to industry oversight, enforcement, scientific research, criminal justice reform, normalization. But what does it really mean? You know, there's two camps. There's reschedule and deschedule. And when Joe Biden put it out there, I mean, I still think it's a political ploy to make sure that he can win the next election. I don't believe he cares anything about cannabis. I think a lot of things he's not capable of doing. But I think he just reads the prompter when he can, including the words like pause and move to the next screen. But anyway, we don't want to reschedule because rescheduling to Schedule 3 would make it prescribable. I believe that the pharmaceutical industry is salivating over this. And it doesn't do anything for legalization. And it doesn't, unless the states adopt this, we're not going to see all this expungement and release of prisoners. We're just not. As opposed to descheduling, which would take it completely off of the schedule and make it available without any kind of legal compromise, without any risk. You just go and get it like you get your vitamin C and your, you know, 40 a beer and your whatever you get that you're allowed to get in this country because you're an adult. And so basically we want the government once again to stop telling us what we can and cannot put in our own bodies. One point that Senator Smitherman made last year was you can't tell a grown person that they can't do something. You can't. They're going to do it anyway. So what would we gain from removal? I mean, this is my overview, guys. The guy we're going to talk to in a minute is going to expound and be way better at this than me. But a few things come to mind. Banking. You know, even if we do deschedule, there still has to be legislation, the Safer Banking Act. We've got to be able to have access to checking accounts, to funding that's not 25% interest, you know, and daily payments for 3 months kind of thing, like you have a 300 credit score. And be able to get lines of credit, loans, things like that, startup loans, all the things that other small businesses really probably take for granted. I have a 5-year-old business with an excellent credit score and cannot get a credit card. Just can't. I can't even use Cash App and Venmo. And, you know, if we put it out there in a free market, you know, you create jobs, you create taxes that we can use for things besides putting people in prison. I mean, think of all the money we would save if we had less prisoners. Now, the private prisons wouldn't like it, and the people that they pay off wouldn't like it, but it would free up so much money that could be put toward education, healthcare, things like that. You would be able to get people to let you have a checking account or invest in your business. I might be able to get people to show up for an event because they're not ashamed to put their name next to mine. We did 420 with zero sponsors, financial sponsors. They were all in kind and we appreciated everything, but no big business that could help us put on a really great event for the cause will have anything to do with these events. And, you know, countless people not going to prison, I think, is a huge plus. The people that have had to go to prison, just think of the last 20 years when any amount of this country, because it started with one state, two states, any amount of people in this country that have gone to prison since that was allowed in any state, to me, is lunacy. Because on one hand, we're giving people licenses and our blessing. You know, hey, go out, grow weed, you know, make products, sell weed to your heart's content. Make all the money you can. We don't care. And, oh, but this guy on this state line, he has to go to jail for 10 years and lose everything he's ever had. And so that is a huge issue. And also, just like I said, the ability to have freedom of choice to be able to use natural medicine as we see fit. And that includes for our children. So I think we're going to put up some links to some information about these things, the Governor DeSantis veto issue and the rescheduling and some more news about Florida. Also, we'll be scrolling the information about the website, about Boro, and about the guest that we're about to have tonight. So make sure that you share this and listen to the show every Monday night at 7 o'clock Central Time here on radio on FM Talk 106.5 and now live streaming via all these different social media sites. Thank you, Shayna. I know y'all remember Shayna from being on the show. Shayna has really stepped up and helped me put this together. Really, she's done all the work on the technical side, and I just showed up with my notes and washed my hair last night. So when we come back, we're going to get to our guest, Michael Camp from the United Empowerment Party, is going to discuss rescheduling versus descheduling. Stay with us.
Welcome back to Sweet Home Cannabama. Now with all the information you want about cannabis, here's your host, Jennifer Booser.
Back, everybody. You're listening to Sweet Home Cannabama every Monday night at 7 p.m. on FM Talk 106.5. And we are live streaming tonight on social media. I want to welcome our guest to the show tonight. We're going to be talking with Michael Camp. He is also a member of the National Industrial Hemp Coalition with me in his state. And he is coming on to represent the United Empowerment Party. Michael, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Jennifer, for having me. FM 106.5 for hosting this. And all the listeners, of course, the number one thing, right? I don't know how this is going to stream on StreamYard. I've got a couple little issues on this end, so okay. I'm just using the phone.
Well, we can see you. We can see a picture of you.
Yeah, and on my end, I was trying to share, so good old technology, right? We navigate with it.
Right.
But yeah, so my name is Michael Camp. I'm a steward of the plant above all else, and one word, edutainment, is what I do. I've been involved with cannabis for about 26 years now. Started at a very young age, understanding the connection with it. And now we can see ourselves. Sweet. I can see you and me, and I don't know if we can be heard. So with it, because I think you're not going to hear through StreamYard, is the radio sound, sorry to divert from my
introduction. No, that's okay. That's okay. This is our first time. We want to get it right.
Perfect. Let's do this right. This is kind of what I do with the National Industrial Hemp Coalition. I'm the CTO and Earth Mother Network and fun little tech things, right? So
mm-hmm.
Is the radio, is your sound being ran into the radio?
Mm-hmm.
And it's from StreamYard, and then it's recording from what your hub is that you're recording on StreamYard and then getting pumped out?
Yeah, I can't answer that. Sorry. I'm not the technical person.
Well, here what's fun is...
Well, we can hear you, and that's all that really matters, because our radio listeners can't see anyway.
Well, we're going to retry it again, and let's see if there's an echo if I do this and unmute on StreamYard.
Okay, because we can see you. You're a little pixelated, but we can see you. And we can hear you.
So now do you hear the echo of the phone on as well?
Yeah.
If I've got the phone on, is there an echo?
I don't hear an echo.
Okay, so cool. Well,
I'm going to let them mess with that while we talk. So tell me, what I want to hear about is the United Empowerment Party. Tell us what that is.
Absolutely. So I've been blessed to be working with United Empowerment Party, formerly known as the National Cannabis Party. Just brought in by Seba Chavez. We meet El Presidente, as we call her, Casita Artist Mills. And her brother, Reggie Noble, are the founders of the United Empowerment Party.
Okay.
So the United Empowerment Party is a federally recognized political party that is dedicated to first uniting the cannabis industry,
mm-hmm.
protect small businesses along the supply chain from being pushed out by large corporations, excessive taxes, and other regulatory conditions that make access limited to those who are economically disadvantaged.
Okay.
So this can be accomplished by electing candidates who support nonpartisan expansion of the cannabis industry through research and development. And the UEP wants to promote the equitable creation of jobs as we seek regulations that will encourage education, scientific advancement, and community engagement that ultimately contributes to the economic growth for all. And I'm reading this straight from the United Empowerment Party's website, which is www.unitedempowermentparty.org.
Mm-hmm.
This is the specifics of their mission, focused around the three C's of community, culture, and collaboration. The vision for the United Empowerment Party is that the UEP works with both federal government and state governments to provide fair and equitable policy and legislation with the cannabis industry. The UEP values voters and candidates alike, regardless of the current political affiliation. Who provide diverse ideas and inclusion solutions for unshackling cannabis access. And the campaign of what's being pushed is hashtag free the green. So checking out United Empowerment Party, they're on all social platforms. Following the founders, the director of community, Keedy Weedy. It's just a plethora of powerhouses. The team is small and lethal because the education, the purpose within it, and then, you know, it actually being about the plant and the people and solutions.
Right. I like that your team, you said your team is small but vicious.
I'd like to
think of myself in that way.
Well, absolutely. And it takes those sound voices, and you know,
yes.
when it comes through, like a lot of us, we could see Safita running for president. And
wow.
Because of what she represents and stands for, and the power of a voice. And
I definitely know that there is power in having a voice where you're willing to actually put yourself out there and say the thing that no one else will say. And that's been my keys of the kingdom.
100%.
Yeah.
So it's just embracing that, empowering it, and being able to do something about it. It's an election year. Votes are currency.
Right.
It's very simple. With this reschedule versus deschedule, it's all smokescreen. I know.
We had that conversation.
Right? And then there's levels of why and what does it do, and it's just certain points of agenda, right, that the industry's been hurting from, like marketing.
Right.
And certain business operations that those shackles and barriers shouldn't exist in the first place.
Right.
So what can we do? We can leverage that the DEA said some things. I watch a lot of cannabis legalization news with Thomas Howard. From what they are reading on and diving into, there's about a 90-day before things can go into that 60-day of our public voice and then that voice has to be responded to, all of them.
Right.
But then it's, we have, what does that mean, right? Response to. We have AI. There's a lot of technology in an email. Get responded to an email with an automated thing is a response. So now it's further education into a, like a fax line and connecting a computer to a fax line that faxes go through that then have to be responded on paper or in a digital form and refax. So there's levels to actually record and
yes,
and catalog our voice in the proper, but then also not be bamboozled by the technology things that will adhere to what the response must be.
Right.
But right, there's all of this distraction.
Right.
So it's simple, leverage what's going on. The plant has a light on it, and the time is now.
Right.
Reschedule isn't the answer, so we get to the opportunity to educate what is.
Reschedule to me is insulting.
100%.
It is a slap in the face because 90% of the population thinks, oh, wow, that's great. And you look crazy going, no, it's not. Because why wouldn't we be happy about it? Because it looks so great. But it's just it's a crock of bull.
It is a crock of a bunch of bull.
Yeah, and no cursing on the show. So, don't you get me kicked off live.
No, I grasped as much.
Okay, good. You know, yes, we have to adhere to the FCC.
You know, it just, like you said, it gives that opportunity for the culture and community and equity empowerment and restorative justice and there's seven principles that the United Empowerment Party lives by. And it says, I'm going to get to the others, representation of in the party. And of course, my internet is going wonky to support seven principles. Hopefully you can still see me on StreamYard. It froze very, very hard.
Yeah, I'm not sure, but we can hear you on the radio, so let's keep it going.
Okay, beautiful. And then it doesn't help I've got 25 things open.
Probably not, Michael. You should have been better prepared.
That's cut down huge.
So you mentioned public comment, you know, what basically is happening? What is the goal here? I know that you guys are working on a petition that you want to send to President Biden, and it's addressed to President Biden, the Vice President, a couple other people. What is the message? And then how many do you need? Let's talk about it. What do you need it to say? What will the 100,000 signatures that you're looking for do for you or us? You know, let's break down the petition.
Well, exactly. It's what it would do for the industry as a whole.
Right.
That 100,000 mark is, if you go and look up, you know, how many signatures on a petition to activate things on a federal level, and that's the number it'll tell you.
What do you mean activate on a federal level? Who's going to care at 100,000? Who are we shooting for?
Enough voices are combined on a petition to take it to a federal recognition.
Okay. What does that mean? Does that mean they're going to take up the issue or that you get an audience
It just gives the power of one sound voice to go into these guidelines of what my understanding of where things get recognized, what number's the big enough number to say, hey, I'm going to pay attention.
So like the DEA already has a certain, connection to the federal government where if the DEA says it, you know, then they have carries a certain weight. Would these 100,000 signatures give weight to the voice of the people who want to deschedule so that we can compete against that other voice?
Correct.
Okay.
So it can be right because it wasn't descheduled, wasn't presented to any of the groups, especially to be brought to the DEA. Only
reschedule.
So in that, now that it's here, why not deschedule? And we get to lean on the science, what a Schedule 1 is and why that's wrong. A lot of us are aware. What a Schedule 3 does in changing everything, adult use, in my understanding, is no longer in existence. It's now all medical. And what will that change? Yes, there's research. Yes, there's availability. But the powers that be that control the money and the research, the data, it's diving in deeper. who's in control of that?
Mm-hmm.
And it starts, you know, showing the face of truth, like you've been dealing with in Alabama and all of this,
yeah,
this craziness that's going on in the industry. And how is it even happening? And it's because most don't know.
Well, I think having experienced it myself many times, every time. Now, this situation that we're dealing with in Alabama with borohemp is probably the most ridiculous, but also the most biggest threat. Because if a health department can just write down on a piece of paper that something's illegal and you can't afford to sue them till they give up... And, you know, you lose $300,000, you lose your business, you lose everything you have. By the way, that the state already knows you've been doing and approves for the last 4 years. No law against it. There's a law supporting it. And yet they can just scribble on a piece of paper that this is illegal and that somehow becomes the truth. I cannot comprehend this. You know, and everything, like you
most
said, reschedule... Reschedule was the only thing presented to them. They didn't get all the options. What does it look like if we also deschedule? What does Schedule 4 look like? What is no schedule? What does it look like to, you know, do away with all of this stuff and just let people do what they do and monitor it like they monitor anything else, tax it like they tax anything else, and stop. The cat's out of the bag. Cannabis is here. Been here long before we were. The only reason we don't have unfettered access in our own backyards to cannabis is money, because it can undo a lot of other industries that are sucking this planet and its people dry. Stay with us. We'll be back with more from Michael Camp.
Welcome back to Sweet Home Cannabama. Now with all the information you want about cannabis, here's your host, Jennifer Boozer.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm your host, Jennifer Boozer, and owner of Cannabama in downtown Mobile. We are Alabama's first hemp dispensary. We started this party, so that's what I like to think, and we have not stopped. So tonight we're talking with Michael Camp. He is a colleague of mine from the National Industrial Hemp Coalition. And he is representing the United Empowerment Party. Michael, let's get to, I mean, because we can complain about the government all day. Let's get to the part where we're going to actually do something, because I'm so sick of only ever talking about things. That happens so much in this industry. One thing I wanted to say from before is I think one of the biggest problems we have as an industry is that everybody is out for themselves. Everybody's secretive. It's like no one wants to talk about anything, share anything, collaborate. Like, how are we? We're like this big compared to all these other industries that are established and that aren't, people aren't ashamed of. And, you know, and nobody walks into a shoe store and asks, what are shoes? You know, and why do I need them? But, you know, it's unique because all of us are facing this just huge mountain of propaganda for almost 100 years and stigma and the lack of ability to get anywhere in life without any funding. And nobody wants to work together. Nobody wants to help anybody. It's the most demoralizing year, I think, I've ever had. And there's been some doozies. But I think in asking for help with our own bills, asking, begging, groveling for help for Boros for our own sake, because, you know, as much as I hate to see them lose their business, at the end of the day, I'm also gonna be in big trouble. And I don't understand why people can't see the collective good in banding together, because nobody wants to listen to one or two people that are in the weed industry. That, you know, most people that can do anything for you sees you a certain way. And so, but when there's a collective of educated and successful people who are articulate and we know exactly what we want and why, that is a collective message that will move mountains. And I don't understand why people are so individual. And I don't know, it's like they're trying to hoard their own little corner for themselves. And because of that, we're all going to lose our corner.
And I think it's a part of it. We've been systematically conditioned and by the stigmatization and
right
the industry itself, right, of others. You know, a lot of it is protection. And
of course, you don't really ever know who you're talking to or what their motive is.
Exactly. And we're talking about a powerful plan.
Yes.
I mean, this is the solution to saving the planet when we get down to the nitty-gritty.
Right. And as big a solution as it is for the human race, it's that big of a threat and more to the people who don't want us to be healthy, who don't want us to be able to choose.
You know, with rescheduling, it's progress forward. Is it? So if the pharmaceutical companies are in charge of the research of something that disrupts their entire business plan.
Right. Exactly.
What do we think will happen?
Well, right. They already tailor their clinical studies to the outcome they want. And then we don't find out about it till 10 years later when everybody's, you know, keeling over from their blood pressure medicine or their cholesterol medicine or whatever it is. You know, they're not going to grow the plant in a way that takes away from what they already have, because they've got us locked in believing anything in a anything someone in a white coat says.
Exactly. You know, so it's the deschedule aspect and just raising that awareness and asking a couple simple questions.
Right.
Right. And then this is that time. So
I also find that when I don't know what your experience is with trying to go and talk to these legislators and talk to these people or listening, like we were listening all day to the Senate and we have been for weeks, there's such a huge, huge gap between what is true and what these legislators know, and it is bad. They can't pronounce cannabinoid half the time. They say things that let you know, whoa, they have no clue what they're even deciding on. They have no clue what they're even saying no to. They just, somebody told them to say no, and hey, weed's easy to say, that's bad, we don't want it.
Exactly.
Well, so let's go to positive now. Let's go to that collective voice so that our listeners, anybody who is watching by the live stream or listening or listening later on the podcast, tell us about the petition and where we can find it, what your ultimate goal. What does the petition say? Give us a nutshell.
In a nutshell, it's just recognizing the power of the plant and what it can do. Period. For shared vision, justice, equity, scientific integrity.
Right.
And as a national importance. You can go to the unitedempowermentparty.org is the simplest.
I was just about to ask you.
Yeah, that'll give you the basic information of who they are. It's the website for the party. Has a button there to go and check out the petition itself.
Okay.
Change.org is where they're running that. We are currently at 6,400 signatures.
And how many days do you have to get 100,000 signatures?
The sooner the better, right? When it comes through of what time frame, when the 60-day public comment will happen, if they're thinking around June.
Okay.
Is when the initial of that 60 days is going to activate.
So you have about a month to try to gather as many as you can.
Correct. And then that another 60 days to leverage, once again, now the announcement of it. Because, like, this reschedule aspect, it's somewhat saying some of it was leaked. And now, like, Cannabis Legalization News, Thomas Howard can tell you the most if you want to listen somewhere, YouTube, all platforms, the top legislation.
What's his name? I want to write that down. What's his name?
Thomas Howard.
Okay.
Collateral Base is his law firm.
Okay.
They were located in Peoria, Illinois.
Okay.
Him and Miggy 420 are the hosts of the show. They've been doing it for 5 years. They've got 60 followers now, 1,000 followers on YouTube, even with the scrutiny and discrimination. Some Facebook pages with 500,000, other things like that.
Okay.
But it is some of the best, if not, I think it is the best news available local, statewide, national. It's unbelievable.
Okay.
Of who he does, what he educates on, and that rescheduling aspect specifically.
All right. So tell us again exactly.
His research shows.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Been determined and signed by Biden yet to get that 60 days, you know, that we then now it's 60 days.
Right.
And then it all has to be reviewed. So it's getting it organized properly.
So they're basically timing it to where they'll decide what to do right before the election when they see how many votes he needs.
Correct. And it looks of like activation through the time of responding, like especially if we do our job properly. There's 110 million people that are yay to cannabis that are registered voters. How many millions are not registered to vote?
Or didn't show up. That's how it is in Alabama, didn't show up. Okay.
So how many of those people would like to voice their opinion?
Right.
This is that opportunity.
Exactly. So tell us again where we can find it. We got about one more minute, and I want to make sure we get that information out there.
100%.
Tell us what your website is.
The website for the party is www.unitedempowermentparty.org.
Yes.
And
we have a link. We have a link available, and we'll be sharing it periodically for the petition. You can go on, sign the petition. It takes no time at all. And basically, if you would like to see legalization, descheduling in the federal government as far as the plan is concerned, please go and sign this petition. We have 1 month. I want to remind everybody before we leave, go and find the Boro Hemp Legal Fund link as well. Go to CannaBama.com. And we will also be at the Gulf Coast Carnival on May 25th. We will have a QR code that you can use. We'll have it in the store. I would highly recommend that any store owners or anybody that is listening that would like to help us gather signatures, there's a QR code that's available that I can get for you. You could put it up and have your customers come in and sign, because most of our customers are going to be pro-legalization. Thank you so much, Michael, for being on the show tonight.
No, thank you so much for having me. And, start your journey with the Power in the Plant, Free the Green campaign. Show your support at unitedempowermentparty.org. And that land, right when you land there, you can get the petition and the information that you need.
Yes, and you can find this podcast version after the show is over on all major streaming services. Thanks again, Michael, for being with us. Join us next week on the next episode of Sweet Home Cannabama. Good night.